Perfect. Thank you.
If you really want enlightenment, then just lighten up.
Blogtalk Radio.
Hello, everybody. Kiler Davenport here in the Great Northwest, online tonight with Mr. Dave Kelso and soon to be Jay Larson, I hope. We've been having a little problem on Skype here. It's probably me at the controls causing
Mercury,
the problem.
Mercury retrograde.
Yeah, dealing with Skype on Ubuntu Linux. There he is right there. Let's see if we can't get him in here. Let me pop this in here and see what's going on. Jay, is that you?
Yes.
Yeah, we are on the air live with Dave Kelso and Jay Larson tonight, ladies and gentlemen, on Maiden Voyage Ministries, which is kind of odd. I haven't done a show on Maiden Voyage in a while, and I've been getting a lot of requests to come back to Maiden Voyage, and here we are tonight live on Blog Talk Radio International, coming to you from Skype. Yeah, live.com, which I want to encourage all of you all to get Skype. I didn't know that this a day and age of great technology that there were so many people that have not even heard of Skype, but that's something that I need to get through my head. Is just because we know a lot of things or this or that or the other doesn't mean that you do, and that's something that I'm going to have to quit generalizing on. I do it a lot. I mean, there's so many people.
Tyler, generalize? No.
Well,
never.
There's so many people that are not even computer savvy. And I just keep forgetting in this day and time, there are still literally, I don't know, millions of people out there that just don't know how to use a computer, and they barely are able to get on Facebook, and then they really don't know even what to do with that. So that's something that I'm going to have to keep banging into my head. And Dave, I know you're guilty too. I mean, we tend to think in this day and age that pretty much everybody's a computer guru, you know, or at least knows how to whiz their way around the net. And that's just not true. You know what I mean?
I'm actually never under that assumption, because worldview paradigms have a lot to do with that too. Just when we insist upon the illusion of difficulty, we can take something that's very simple and overcomplicate it for ourselves. The main problem that people have is just the age-old stigma that goes back to the 90s and the 80s that, oh, computers are supposed to be uber-complicated and blah, blah, blah. This day and age, they're very easy. I mean, people just got to get it through their heads. You don't have to be a tech or a programmer. It's kind of like a car. You don't have to be an automotive technician in order to just be able to drive the damn thing and change the oil.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to say that I came on tonight to talk a little bit about faith and fear. You know, there's a lot of faith out there. There's a lot of fear out there. And when you mix a lot of fear with a lot of faith, it really waters things down, and it just becomes like an I love you that's said over and over and over again, where your spouse doesn't even hear it after a while, like the train running down the track or the clock ticking. I wanted to come on the air tonight and, number one, let everyone know that my bark is a lot worse than my bite. A lot of you have been talking to me and coming back to my Facebook page and coming back to our platforms and networks, and, you know, you've all come back and said, you know, when I first started listening to you, Kiler, I really thought you were crazy and outlandish and outspoken, and I still do, by the way, but you've taught me a lot. You've taught me a lot about being outspoken and about saying what's on your mind and about not holding things back. And actually, I've strengthened a lot of people out there, and I've made a lot of people stop and think about just how lukewarm it is and how meaningless it is not to say what's on your mind and to hold things back. And some people are tactful and some people are not very tactful. I'm not one of the tactful ones, but I will tell you that I do believe in God. This is Maiden Voyage Ministries tonight, and this is what I came to talk about tonight, is I do believe in God. I don't like that word higher power, but I will say that I do believe in a higher power. AA uses that word a lot. I used to go around and around with them because they would not confess the word God, or they would not confess the word Jesus Christ, or even allow the word Jesus Christ to be brought up in an AA meeting. They would literally throw you out on your ear in the South even mentioned the blood of Jesus Christ. So we went around and around and around for a long time with those organizations, because I had a lot of friends who were AA members, and they were having a lot of trouble with it. So anyway,
well,
I didn't come
on
the air to
talk about... Well, if you use the term higher power, you could just use the term the Creator. I don't think any religion's going to dispute that.
Well, you'd be surprised. The Pentecostals would throw you in jail, but I mean... It's
really?
You know, it's not, yeah, it's not, you know, it's so complex, and that's one of the things I wanted to talk about tonight, is the complexity. We've turned, you know, there's so many religions, there's 17,000 languages on the planet today, and, you know, that's a lot of different languages with a lot of different viewpoints and a lot of different vectors, if you will, mathematically speaking, and a lot of different perspectives out there. So when you consider 17,000 languages, and when you consider over 2,700 religions, and that's not including the sub-religions and the cults.
Yeah,
there's
over 40,000 different denominations of Christianity alone.
Yeah, but you're talking about a lot of different opinions, a lot of different hypotheses, and a lot of different theories, a lot of different definitions. It's really difficult for anyone to get a handle on this thing. It's you know, I was telling you guys back in the old days in the 60s, you know, we lived a very simple life. You know, we went to school, we went to church, we came home and had Sunday dinner. We rode horses, we went fishing, and we knew kind of where we were going, kind of where we'd been, and we kind of basically had a pretty good grasp of where we were at the time. And
logged into the internet using real logs while trying to avoid the T-Rex.
Yeah, and all of those things nowadays have kind of just gone out the window. It's like there's just too much information out there for the average person, especially older people, senior citizens, to grasp or even want to grasp. And then you have the younger people, say age 11 to 16, who are just so confused and screwed up and twisted, and, you know, their minds are so perverted already because they've been brought into this particular culture in the United States, that I say, okay, well, by the time you're born, you traded your birth certificate for $1 million or $2 or $3 or $4 or $5 million worth of debt that the government's borrowing on you at the Fed. You know, the minute you're born, they take your birth certificate and they mix it with all the birth certificates of that week, and they take it over to the Fed and they borrow $100 zillion on your labor that you're going to put forth over your lifetime. Now, this is a pretty interesting thing, and if you'll research this on the internet, you'll see that this is the case.
I've researched it on the internet, and it is the case.
Yeah, and people are pretty screwed up.
They do that in Canada, too. Did you know that?
Yeah. All governments try their best to trade the birth certificates for the future labor, and it works, you know. But anyway, that's not what we came to talk about tonight. What I came to talk about tonight was it's good for all of you Christians who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as personal Savior, and who believe in God, and who read your Bible, and have your Sunday dinners, and have your families over, and just live a simple life. Many of you think that I think that's just insane and crazy and nuts, and all of you ought to be out in the street hooping and hollering and running and protesting and occupying, and that's not the case at all. That's not what I think. I admire those of you who are not me, who do not think like I do. I admire those of you who are not in the position that I'm in. I admire those of you who do not have the personality that I do, the type A, get it done now, let's go personality, you know, because obviously I have a lot of PTSD, I have a lot of
going 90
stress.
Miles an hour into the brick wall and then wondering what happened.
But that is just the business. That is just the nature of the beast. You know, we all have our gifts. Dave and I have talked about this. Jay and I have talked about this. We all have our gifts, and the object here is to try to get along. That's the object, and that's one of the reasons why I wanted to come on the air tonight during this 2 hours. I want to talk about how we're not getting along, how we think we're getting along, but we're not getting along at all. there's just too many people doing too many things, and we're too scattered out, and there's too many different religions, and too many different cultures, and too many different experiences, and too many different perspectives, and you're not ever going to get everyone on the same page.
Well, Kyler, to be fair, there's a lot of people getting along and a lot of people not. You know, for every paradigm you can think of, you know, there's an existence for it. So there's people getting along, there's people not getting along, there's people that don't know whether to get along or not. There's all different, you know, spectrums. It's not just black.
And what I want to, tonight is try to bring that, get out of that circular argument, as I call it, and try to get some consensus, try to get some kind of...
Good and bad attitude, not a this or that. As a matter of fact, because I tend to basically fly in circles of people who do get along, you know what, one of the biggest things that can sometimes stress that type of group of people the hell out, the ones that do get along, trying to figure out how to show the rest of the people who aren't getting along that not only is it easy to get along, but it's more efficient. You know, people have been taught, you know, raised in this, what you might call a subtraction and division economy, and they think that a addition and multiplication attitude is ludicrous and ridiculous, but that's like saying 2 plus 2 equals 1, or, you know, 10 times 30 equals 12 or something. It's really ridiculous and illogical, because the more we quote-unquote grow up, the more childish we become, and the more caught in our behaviors and patterns, and what you put energy into grows. So if you're putting energy into being combative and competitive and adversarial and hostile, you're just going to get better and better and better at doing that. And the longer you're in a certain paradigm, it's, you know, like you mentioned already, it's more difficult to unlearn and relearn. So, I mean, one of the main conundrums is, you know, trying to figure out how to get these other people to understand that getting along is possible. And as you and I discussed, I think it was last night, the night before, something like that, you can't convince anybody of anything, especially not by force. The only thing you could do is, like Gandhi said, be the change you want to create. Be that example of what's possible. Be the elephant in the room. Because people in their paradigms are like, okay, they have these certain rules that they set up for their reality, reality being a quantum hologram anyway, and they have these assumptions set up. If I put out this, I can only get back that reflection. So, like, if people think, you know, people suck and all people are going to do is be mean to me, so when I raise hell and bitch and gripe about this, then people are going to raise hell back, and that's the way it is. And just like you've also done on the air and other places many times yourself, Kyler, when someone does that, you give them a different reflection. You be that example, that elephant in the room. So now they got to shut up and stop and think about themselves, because you've literally violated the laws of their universe. You gave them a positive reflection when all their thinking says you should have given them a negative. So then they got to stop and think, why did that happen? And that's really what wakes people up more than, like you said, hooping and hollering and get out there and saying, you fuckers.
I wanted to say, let's respect Maiden Voice tonight, and all of us keep our tongues, and not use profanity on this God. This is my God channel, so let's all, me included.
Fracking. We'll just pass a little gas tonight. We'll call it fracking.
Well, yeah, I've got a lot of wonderful people out there who are not into profanity, and I don't want them to leave us. I don't want them to hang up. But they do know me, and they do know that I will respect that tonight. Yeah, I agree,
Dave, 100%.
I respect that, and I agree with what you said. And, you know, there's nights that I lay here and I pray. You know, people want to know about me. They want to know about Kyler Davenport. There's nights that I lay here in the bed and I pray. Mary goes to work at 11, and then I get back down the mountain about 11:07, believe it or not. slow down, Kyler. But, you know, the deer running out in front of me sometimes slows me down, wild turkeys. But I come back home, and I'll lay here, and I'll just pray, you know, and I'll ask God to please just give me a sign, you know. Please just show me something, and please tell me that I'm not praying to a wall or to an empty spot, you know. And I know that many people in the audience do that. They email me and tell me that they do the same thing, you know, even Christians, even preachers.
Tyler, yeah. Question. Am I allowed to get a little esoteric and quantum physical, or should I not go there with this particular group?
Not too heavy tonight. We've got a lot of our seniors with us tonight, and I want to just kind of be sweet grandma, grandpa tonight. But I pray and ask the Lord to help me, because I grew up in that culture, and I grew up in vacation Bible school and church and Sunday school, and I'm proud of that, and I'm thankful for that. There's nothing wrong with that, you know. I'm not justifying it. I'm just telling you that, to me, there's nothing wrong with that. And as I've gotten older, I've gotten wiser in a lot of ways, and I've also gotten stupid in a lot of ways, you know, because I left my roots. I left my culture of Sunday school. I left my culture of Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, Corinthians, Galatians 1 and 2, and Ephesians, and I left the vacation Bible school mentality that God is going to be there for us and he's going to take care of us and that all is well, you know. Let God work difficulty stuff out. Go ahead, Dave.
When it comes to looking for a sign, an old saying comes to mind: praying is talking to God, meditation is listening. People always forget about the listening part.
Well, they do. They're so busy asking for that new car and that new home and for Susie to get her blue ribbon at the football game on Monday and for Bobby to get a blue ribbon at the soccer game. You know, it's just people use God like a genie. You know, a lot of people do. Even Christians who have been in church for a long time, they'll pray things like, oh, Lord, please tell me at work tomorrow to get a raise. And, Lord, when I get home, please let my husband have that new car in the driveway that we've been praying for. And, Lord, please just give us a bigger house. We need a 4-bedroom instead of a 3. And, Lord, those jet skis look so nice at the store the other day. You know, it's just like Santa Claus. And, and damn it, I went to a Buddhist, you know. I go to my Buddhist retreats up here, and, you know, Nam-myoho-renkyo, please give me a new car, please give me a new home, please give me this, please give me that. It's all, everybody's sitting around with their wish list, and I'm thinking, people, let's back up.
Yeah, the universe ain't the quantum version of the home shopping network.
ridiculous, you know. Let's just thank the Lord and leave it at that. Let's just thank the Lord, you know, and people look at me and like, well, thank the Lord for what? You got to thank him for something. And I go, no, you don't. And they go, well, whoa, you don't. Go ahead.
Can I remind everybody of what Jesus said about exactly what all you're talking about there?
Sure.
When Jesus gave us the Lord's Prayer, he said, the Lord already knows that which you need, so this is how you should pray. Notice the Lord's Prayer is a prayer of thanks.
Yes.
Because what Jesus understood, because remember, God granted all of us the gift of free will. And so the reason Jesus was all about unconditional love and being kind to your neighbor and so on and so forth is, I mean, even the physics embedded in every atom points to what you put out, you get back. So if you're all, oh, please God, I don't have this and I don't have that, and if you're in a particularly good mood today, maybe you can grant this miserable sinner this or that or whatever, then God respects your free will.
Hmm.
And what people don't realize that they're saying when they do that is they're actually putting out an affirmation of, I don't have, I don't have, I don't have. And God is not going to step in and usurp your free will. God gave that to you as a gift, and he's not going to give it to you and then be like, ah, just kidding, take it away, you know.
Right.
He's not going to do that.
April Fool's.
He's going to respect your free will. So if you keep affirming to yourself about how bad everything is, you're going to get that back. But if you're in a state of thankfulness, even scientists have realized that thankfulness and its opposite are a frequency that you're emanating, and that's how the what you put out, you get back thing works. You could call that the Holy Spirit. you know, you can call that whatever you want, but it is proven to work, whether you're looking at it spiritually, scientifically, whatever. It's one of the things
I guess
we can agree on.
I guess you saw the piece I wrote today about some of my past again, and I had a woman email me and say, "Oh my God, you know, I've known you all this time, and I had no idea that you'd been in blood up to your, you know, waist, and I had no idea you'd worked all these plane crashes, and I had no idea that you'd been in the morgue and burned all these bodies and embalmed all these bodies and started at 14 years old, and I had no idea that you'd picked up all those body parts and heads and arms and legs, and I, you know." And she's like, "I just don't know. We don't know each other on this thing. We judge people, and I feel like crying," she said, because I thought
would like
you
to
were
get
just
to Jesus's main point, though.
Well, go ahead. I was going to bring up, but you brought something interesting up about the prayer and asking for things. Go ahead and finish, please.
Well,
and then I'll
because appreciation is actually a frequency that your atomic structures are emanating. So what you put out, you get back. That feeling of appreciation and thankfulness, the genuine feeling, not tricking yourself, not dusting all your negative feelings under the rug like the New Agers do and pretending you're thankful. But, I mean, the genuine feelings of thankfulness and appreciation, that's a frequency you're sending out. So your physical reality can't help but reflect that back. And you ever notice right before Jesus would heal somebody, he kept asking them, "Do you have faith? Do you have faith? Do you have faith? Yes, I have faith. I have faith." He was generating that frequency, those emotions of faith inside of the person. And all he'd do is channel their energy back into them to heal them. And ever notice, he would say, "Your faith has healed you." He didn't say, "Oh, yeah, I'm the man. I healed you. High five."
He said,
"Your faith has healed you. You have healed you." And he said, "All that I have done,
faith,
I should tell you, do in greater
he
still."
He said, your faith has made you whole. That says it all. Your faith has made you whole.
He said, "We are like him. The only difference is he knows that we don't."
Right, of course. And the reason I brought that up a while ago about my past and that letter piece that I wrote was because I wanted to, this lady said, "You know, I understand now why you're like you are. And I understand now where you're coming from when you curse and when you get mad and when you piss, you know, you just get out there and just really go bonkers on people for saying, 'Oh, it's such a beautiful day in the neighborhood. Go hug your puppy dog.'" You know, I go, "No, F you." Because, you know, and when I tell them how many starving people there are in the world, and when I tell them how many wars there are in the world, when I tell them how many women are being sold into slavery and kids are being molested and sold into slavery, they say, "Oh, my God, I didn't know any of those things were going on." And I say, "Well, they are." And, you know, it's like you and I have gotten this argument before, and I dang sure don't want to argue tonight. I don't want to go head-to-head with you on this, Dave, tonight.
There's going
to
be no argument.
People, you know, how can I, standing in my morgue over there with knives in the chest and all these tubes coming out of these old and young people, and I'm ripping pacemakers out of people with a scalpel, and I've got gang members in there that have been killed and bludgeoned, and, you know, how can I say, "Oh, it's a wonderful day in the neighborhood, you know, let's go pet our puppy dog"? You know, I can't. And it's when I'm running my missions, I can't. And so there's definitely a dichotomy there. There's definitely something that I'm trying to express to people that maybe you can express even better than myself, what I'm trying to say and what that lady meant by, you know, "Gosh, I'm glad I know that now about you, because now I know where you're coming from," you know.
Yeah.
When you see people on this digital...
Definitely.
When you see the people on this digital platform, you just see a blank nothing. All you see is text, you know, and how do you sum all that up? You know, well, you don't. You just see what you see is what you get, and that's what you judge, you know, is the text. Mm-hmm. And when people start to get to know you a little bit better, they start to understand you a little more, and they start to come into your world a little more. And even the most staunch Christian would say to me, well, wow, I'll just shut up. I've never in my life experienced anything like that, nor would I ever want to. And now I understand you, and I love you. So tell me, what am I trying to say?
Mind if I illustrate your point for you?
Yes, please.
You see, because there's different sets of knowledge that you have, because you've been around the block a lot more than once, that understandably some of this knowledge conflicts. Like, you understand about appreciation, you understand about frequency, about the quantum hologram, about the Holy Spirit, you understand that, you know, what Gandhi said, become the change, so on and so forth. You understand about frequency, so you do understand, obviously, that to start changing things around, just to have that faith in God and the quantum physics and the Holy Spirit, all that, and resonate that frequency of appreciation, because you already know that that literally affects the physical reality and changes things for the better, but you also know that it has to be done genuinely. You can't pretend you're in an appreciative mode. You can't dust everything else you're feeling under the rug like the New Agers do and go, oh, I'm not looking at that, and pretend, right? Because then you create what's called a quantum interference pattern. It just messes the whole thing up. And you actually get worse than you had before because you're adding resistance, and it just, And, you know, and at the same time, you've been through all the hell you've been through. And what really aggravates you, I think, is that a lot of people expect you to make this huge leap from the total negative all the way up into the total positive, saying, well, you understand this stuff, Kiler, blah, 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 you know, why aren't you... blah, blah, blah. And what they don't realize they're expecting you to do is being in the Atlantic Ocean and not taking the locks through the Panama Canal and expecting you and your ship to just jump over the landmass and just magically land in the Pacific Ocean. And that's ridiculous. You know, you got to start at the ground level and acknowledge you're there to even know there's an elevator to take up
and
to the top.
I think people don't understand either that Mary and I go to church functions, and we go to Buddhist functions, and we go to Hindu functions, and we set up tables, and I actually make cookies and set up chairs and actually sit and laugh and talk to people and hug people's necks and kiss them on the cheek, and I be kissed. And, you know, people, well, I'm saying it tonight. I'm letting people know that I am a human being. You know, I people know that I'm war-torn. You know, they know. My friends up here know where I've been. And
But
you know, those are
the
people
the point I'm trying to make to validate you, though, is that people got to be kind of understanding about where you're coming from and kind of take you through that canal, you know? Like I said, and like you've done to people before, showing someone that different reflection. Because if you put out that hostility and you don't see a different reflection, then how are you supposed to know that anything else other than what you've been experiencing is realistically possible for you? Well, like you said, you're a human being. It's an unrealistic thing to expect of you. So when you put out your, as you like to say, your piss and vinegar, you know, reflect back that compassion instead of, you know, shooting off back at you in a rage. And that's exactly how Jesus operated. And
I will admit tonight on the air that I jump the gun a lot, and I don't want to mess around with people that I feel like are just, you know, they've never been anywhere, they've never done anything. That's just not my gift. It's just not who I am. When I see people posting post after post after post after post after post about all this bullshit about, oh, I saw Grandma at Thanksgiving and Uncle Bobby got a new pair of socks and we did this and the doggy jumped up and we're going to go to soccer tomorrow and we're getting a new ring and I'm getting my hair done and, oh, it's going to look so pretty. I just want to say, fuck you. You know, I just want to say, what the...
Okay,
hell, are you talking about?
Tyler, this is New Voyage.
Can you hear me? Okay, easy on the language, though.
Voyage Ministry, Kiler.
I'm running my people off here. No, they love me. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, everybody. I apologize, everyone.
Let's pass some gas, and he's fracking, not, you know.
Okay, but really, I just want to apologize. You know, I do jump the gun a lot, and it's just, it's who I am. You know, I come from this nasty bloodbath, and it's just, you know, it's hard for me. It's so hard for me to explain to people, you know, handling little fetuses and putting little sockies on them and little headdresses and putting them in caskets and having families want to have a funeral for fetuses. I've done that so many times. And to burn bodies and to watch their brains fry and to look in there and say, oh, they're well done now. I guess we can take them out. No, there's still a little oozing going on in there. People don't understand. And I guess, why do I have this need to make them understand where I'm coming from? It's like, do I need to even do that?
Let me answer that for you. Would you like an answer? It's the exact same problem that, shall we say, the people that are able to get along and are experiencing, for lack of a better term, the quantum abundances or the Holy Spirit or whatever it is you want to call it, trying to get people that are in the opposite negative to understand. All humans have a desire for that relation and that coming together and that unity. And this world for thousands of years now has not been about unity. It's been about segregation and pulling things apart. And the world is only now starting to come together. So we are all really new at this coming together thing as a human race. We are doing it, but we're really new to it. And the old paradigm is dying, kicking and screaming and making a lot of noise. And it's, you know, it is dying.
People tell me, some people that are real prima donnas, I call them, they'll tell me, why do you have to come in here and piss on our party? Why do you have to come in here and disrupt our perfect little lives? Why did you even have to bring that up? And I'm like, oh, Alice, I'll knock you to the moon. You know, what are you talking about? You know, it's like,
you know,
people
what I, you know, do... What I would say, you know what I would say to that? I would
say,
people do it all the time. I'd say he's got the right to express himself just as much as you do. There's nothing right or wrong or good or bad or whatever. It's just a human right to express themselves. And, you know, if you don't like it, don't listen. Walk away. There's no need to. I mean, how can someone say, I'm all goody-goody, gotty, lovey, whatever, but then when they come up against opposition, instead of being the love that they say they are,
they turn into a heathen. They turn into a complete maniac. You know, they're professing all this love. I have people, this is what bugs me too. I have people on these Christian groups, and they all profess love and understanding and compassion and giving and intuitiveness. And then when I get on there and I ask for prayer, they'll go, well, what do you need prayer for? And I'll go, well, I'm reaching out to you because, you know, I'm needing prayer today. My PTSD is really bad. Well, what's PTSD? Well, I was in da-da-da-da-da, and I tell them, we're going to have to put you out of the group. And I go, what? Well, we're going to have to just ban you from the group. You just can't use these. You can't talk about death or any of that stuff. You just can't talk about starving children or nothing. And I'm going, and see, these are, Dave, listen, these are the people that just bug me to death.
Well, I know what those type of people are like, and it's like I say, I had to leave the church to find God.
Yeah.
That's the honest truth.
Jay, you get where I'm coming from, Jay, on that? I know Dave does.
Well, I call those type of people.
It forces you within yourself, you know, all those things. But they're entitled to whatever they feel and believe.
Oh, boy, you got to do that.
All you do is send love and walk the other direction.
But, you know, it's like you, Jay, you're always trying to tell people to prepare, prepare, prepare. And people look at me going, what are we preparing for? We're fine. Mm-hmm. We have a brand new car. We have a brand new home. The kids are dressed nice. The school is wonderful. We're going to game next week. What are you nuts preparing for? What are you nuts talking about? Why don't y'all get in the real world? Why don't y'all get in the real world with us?
Yeah, the good and the bad are arising equally, and if you're not aware of the nature of both, there's this little thing called the Darwin Awards that I'm sure most people are going to be familiar with. That's what's to prepare for, that knowledge. Because, I mean, you know, even science has shown that the frequencies are changing, the physics are changing, and the old materialistic, corrupted crap. You see all these infrastructure failures, how all the old systems based on greed and corruption are no longer working.
We have literally bled this country dry. We have literally bled this country dry with our selfishness and our greed and our hypocrisy our being two-faced and hypocritical. And, you know, it's if we would just go back and look at the Bible, using the Bible as an example, as one great book, and just look at the basics in Proverbs. If people would just look at the basics in Proverbs, or people that ask me all the time, well, why does God do such bad things to people, and why does he let all these things happen, Kiler, that you tell us about? And I say, go read Habakkuk. And they do, and they come back and go, oh, okay, I didn't know. Read Habakkuk. It tells you why God allows these things to happen. And at the same time, I'm still confused about that. But if people would just do what we have the capability to do, if we would do what we learned in Sunday school and kindergarten, and if we would follow the golden rule, we wouldn't be having any of these problems. That's what, you know, one of the reasons I wanted to come on the air tonight was to say, look, if all of you stop complaining and complaining and complaining and just go out and do something, we can turn this country around. But if we just keep sitting around on Facebook philosophizing and theorizing, and everybody's a guru and everybody's an internet expert and everybody's an expert on mysticism and this-ism and that-ism, it's not going to do a damn bit of good for anyone in this country, let alone overseas. We've got enough problems in this country to solve without trying to take over the Middle East, without trying to change the world across the sea. We've got problems here, and we have the capabilities to make these changes. What boggles my mind is we have umpteen zillion churches in this United States of America. And within that group, we should have at least one half of 1% of people that could make these changes, and these changes are not being made. We still have one of the most corrupt governments on the planet. We still have a banking cartel. We still have a Fed that's privately owned. We're selling the people out. We're selling our economy out. We're selling our jobs overseas. We're ruining this country. And it's all because of people's lack of confidence in themselves. It's a lack of education. It's a lack of intuitiveness. It's a lack of intelligence, general, basic, common sense intelligence. And if people would just follow the golden rule, but you know what? We don't. We follow our passions. We follow our pleasures. We follow our lust. We're massive consumers, and we just need to get back to basics, but we will not. We will not get back to basics. Are you all still there?
Yes.
Yeah, I thought I'd lost somebody. Put something on hold here. Let me see who this is. Yeah, who's there? Who's online?
Yeah, I kind of sort of got kicked off and calling back.
I messaged
you on Skype. Apparently, didn't see it.
No, I'm okay. I was on a roll there. I'm just trying to say that if we could just get back to basics in this country, and this is something that blows my mind, even to the point of a conspiracy theory. You know, it brings me to fluoride. It brings me back to HAARP. It brings me back to CERN. It brings me back to NASA. It brings me back to the nanotechnology.
Would you like to know something that when I learned it in parochial school, it didn't really make much sense when I was in Christian school, but now it's making a lot more sense these days. And I mean, I'm sure you probably learned the same thing as what I'm trying to, you know, what I'm about to say, because Christian parochial school is what it is, right? Remember when they taught us that in the end times, or you know, whatever it is that you want to refer to it as, whatever label you want to put on it, that there will be a force that is deceiving the world, false bringers of light, so on and so forth. But there's also going to be the force that, you know, some people call it the awakening, the ascension, whatever the heck you want to call it. But needless to say that everyone's going to have that choice of, you know, which direction do you want to go. And I was thinking back then, because, you know, this is the 1990s, you know, our current mode of communication didn't exist, and I was thinking, how is everybody in the world going to know what's going on, or being given the choice, or whatever? And when you're given the choice, who in their right or wrong mind would honestly pick the negative side, right? And now it makes so much sense to me. I mean, you've got the internet, you've got all these metaphysical awakenings where, like, you know, Joe Blow didn't know anything one day, and the next day he's going, holy crap, I know all this stuff about God and the universe and all this and that, am I going crazy? And then they go find other people that are having a similar experience. It's like, oh, I'm apparently not going crazy. So there's all these different, you know, avenues that people are getting this choice, or as Bill Hicks liked to say before he died, may he rest in peace, it's a choice between fear and love. And now I can see why a lot of people would choose fear, because they're so addicted to things being as they've been and so afraid of change. And they've got their heads in the sand. And, you know, what the Bible and everything was talking about, that, you know, scientists are understanding now, is that the vibratory rate of, you know, the Earth, the solar system, perhaps even the galaxy or the universe, I don't know, is going up. And the higher frequencies are connected to that which we have labeled as love or unconditional love. The lower is that which we have labeled as fear or negativity or what have you. And all these systems of the world have been grounded in this negativity, in this fear, in this greed, in this war, and everything we depend on and have depended on, the infrastructure, is grounded in this garbage. And that's why we see all these infrastructures, you know, falling apart. And for those of us who try to cling to the old ways as they are being torn apart, you know how the Bible said 2/3 of the earth will be destroyed? Well, they didn't mean so much as by natural cataclysms or wars or whatever, but our own paradigms are going to kill us. Because if frequencies keep rising, and if you're a person that's holding on to the lower negative, you know, it's kind of like, I mean, frequency is what it is. What happens if you stick your fingers in the electrical wall outlet? It's not going to, you know, end well for you. So, you know, it's, you know, people's own paradigms are killing them. You see increases in disease. You see advanced aging. I mean, you see just all these 10 zillion different ways that, you know, people can win a Darwin Award. And if you really look at it, what's bringing them into that state? It's their paradigms clinging to the old ways, because your paradigm will affect your choices. And as you know, Kyler, there are wise choices and there are ones that are not so wise. And if you make too many not so wise ones, well, you know,
in my younger
time.
in my younger days, I made some bad decisions, and I can surely tell you that I learned from them, and some people don't. And I've learned, and I was afraid, and I was scared, and I was paranoid, and I was terrified, and, you know, I learned. Some people, it just seems, don't have the capacity to learn. They just keep going back and back and back, like a dog. We talked about licking up his vomit, the Bible says. Men go back to their sin over and over and over again. And every time they'll say, oh, I'm sorry, Lord. 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 And, you know, the Bible says that to forgive our brothers and sisters 70 times 7. That's a lot, you know. Forgive your brothers and sisters 70 times 7. But, you know, as
they,
the Lord forgave
they do,
us.
They do have, yeah, they do have the capacity, but there's the free will factor. I mean, it's, again, people clinging to the old ways because they fear change, and they don't realize that as the bad rises, it means the good is rising too.
Well, I'm also talking about these greedy politicians who just keep taking and taking and taking, and these CEOs that make 920 times the rate of their employees now in salary. And, you know, it just keep taking and taking and taking. You know, I'm not specifically talking about the paradigm of just simplicity and change and transformation, but I'm talking about someone who just willfully gets into Congress to become a part of the elite and just steal from the people, just outright, just steal and just take and let people starve to death. Command the UN not to go in. Command the Red Cross not to go in and feed people. Let them die. Let them starve. We need to get rid of, you know, 9/10 of that particular country. That's
horrible. There's something I'm curious as to whether or not you've noticed.
What?
You ever notice that as the frequencies are rising and the time compression kicks in more and more, the whole physics of what you put out, you get back, is a lot shorter than it used to be?
Yeah.
So that's why we're seeing all these corrupt people getting their butts handed to them. Because in the past, you know, it might have been 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years before what they put out, they get back, comes back and kicks them in the butt. And by the time it kicks them in the butt, they're too old to
give
an ass anyway. But now it's coming back right away.
Technology. Yeah, but there's more technology now, too, and this sound, you know, our voices travel at the speed of bang, bang, bang. I mean, so, you know, you can fart in Dallas and smell it in Chicago in 30 seconds. I mean, it's back when you're talking about, you couldn't do that. People didn't know what was going on, you know.
Oh, yeah.
But now you can't do anything without everyone knowing what's going on, you know.
Yeah.
You can't even
say
something down at the local 7-Eleven anymore without somebody putting it on the Internet.
That's what the word apocalypse means. Most people think apocalypse means the destruction. No, it means all that was hidden in secret, you know, becomes unveiled.
Becomes known,
And I believe there's a difference between secret and privacy. Privacy is your right to not have everybody know the exact details of what you maybe did in the bathroom 10 minutes ago when you were sitting there reading your newspaper. Secrecy is things that affect humanity in a not-so-wonderful way. That is secrecy.
But, you know, Jesus also said that he would turn us over to our wicked and perverse ways in the end, which means he would just let us go. There would be, you know, he'd get to a point... get to a point to where we're turned over to our doggish ways. There's not going to be a lot of redemption. There's not going to be a lot of salvation. There's not going to be a lot of God or the universe or quantum physics intervening. As you said, when those vibrations start to rise, and if people aren't ready to go with it, they're just going to be turned over to their wicked ways. They're going to be given that gift to wallow in it, and there's not going to be much hope. There's not going to be much hope for those folks who decide to just keep doing bad and just continue to hurt people and abuse people and con people and lie to people and take from people. You know, I mean, there comes a point where everything has to come to a head. Everything has to come to a head sooner or later in every generation, in every culture. Things come to a head. And I believe that this particular generation is coming to a head now, you know. I'm not saying it hadn't happened before. It's happened hundreds of times, thousands of times. But it's definitely happening in my lifetime. I'm seeing a major culmination of factors come together where the steam pot is going to blow up.
Man,
it's ready to blow, you know.
You know what? I mean, you know, like you said about the physics and people's paradigms and everything else, I personally don't believe that there's, like, a place somewhere called hell that a so-called loving God is just going to toss people into. We,
no,
of our own free will, create, just hear me out, we create our hell here of our own choosing, and we have the chance to emotionally clear and get on the right track here. And I think that for the people that don't do it here, like these people that are, you know, all these genocides and greed and all the stuff you're talking about, the people that don't do it here, when they inevitably end up gone off the earth and, you know, their soul goes before God, I think God is going to welcome them back with open arms. But here's the thing. Now their soul is in the full knowing of the universe. So now they have to face all at once every nasty thing that they ever did to anybody. And because now they are at one with everything, they will experience it from the perspective of their victims. They will experience the pain. They will experience the torture. They will get,
you know,
that backlash.
Something that used to really scare me when I was a small child was the part in the Bible where it says, all of your sins will be exposed before everyone. Your sins will be open to everyone to see. I used to think, oh my God, no. Some of the stuff I've done, I wouldn't want the dog to see it.
You know what I've learned? I wear all my mistakes as a... as a badge of honor of learning, because like you, I learn from my mistakes. And what that allows for is relation with other people. Because if you've overcome stuff, but, you know, someone's looking at what you've overcome and, you know, they're putting you on a pedestal, the only reason they're putting you on a pedestal is because they think you can't relate to them and their hell and their suffering. And
well,
when you put your mistakes out there for all to see, then all of a sudden the other person knows you can relate to them, and they're like, oh, he's been there too. She gets it. He gets it. So there's hope, because he's been through what I've gone through and more, and he overcame it. So that means there's hope for me. But if
the other person
doesn't understand that you can relate, then they're going to look at you like, what does he know about what I've been through?
Well,
there's no hope for me.
I inject truth serum with my presence with people, and they just tell me everything. And that's, I've also had that gift. You know, when I'm here, or even on the phone with someone, or even whatever, Skype, you know, people just open up to me because they know for some reason they can sense that I've been the worst of the worst. For some reason, they can sense that I understand the drug addict with a needle in both arms, the alcoholic, the pervert, the wife beater, the bank robber, the arsonist. You know, in my halfway houses, I had people from all persuasions. Some I couldn't even mention on the air. They were reaching the Dahmer stages, and I can sit down and talk to any of these people.
Because you understand that victim and perpetrator are exactly the same thing. Those who were victims tend to go down that perpetrator route because that's all they know. That's all they've been taught. When one thing
and
is all you've been taught, when you've been taught abuse and that's all you know, that's all you know how to respond back with.
And that perpetuates the cycle. And I don't see anyone as bad.
I don't either.
You know, and Jesus didn't either. Jesus made a lot of comments about people and a lot of analogies about people, but he never made judgments about people. If people have ever really read the Bible,
this is true.
You know, he understood people, and he knew that people had this capability. He knew that people were flesh and bone and blood, And he knew that they were prone to filthiness and dirtiness and rottenness and all of these things. And
he,
you know,
knew that it didn't have to be that way.
Right.
It didn't have to.
Right.
We have a choice in the matter.
He's given us an out. And not everyone decides to take it early. Some people wait until their last breath. One of my uncles waited till his last breath. You know, he used to curse God, and he would look up at the sky and just curse God, and he would drown little kittens in jars and in front of the family, and he would just drown little puppies. He was really a mean guy, but he had a lot of things going on in his head. He was a former cop, and he was really messed up in the head, very angry. And on his deathbed, he screamed out for the Lord Jesus Christ for the blood to fall upon him. And he said, oh, Father, please do not forsake me. Please, please, oh, God, do not forsake me. And the family's eyes got as big around as silver dollars in that room.
I mean, I can imagine.
Not believe he was crying out like he was in hell.
Would you like my opinion as to why he's crying out?
And I mean, this was a cry that you have never heard before. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, what a lot of people believe, and it makes sense on the, you know, from the quantum understanding too. In that last minute or two of your life, the veil between life and death is gone. So
he died.
Twenty-two
minutes from when he started, he died.
Oh, really? Well, then he got that veil knocked loose a little earlier than most. Then, but when that veil is gone, it's almost like you're in two states at once. You're here and on the other side at the same time, and you've got that full understanding. So he got the truth pushed in his right up on him,
He died the biggest smile and tears coming out of his eyes. He died with the biggest release and relief of body tension that I've ever seen, and I've seen a lot of people die in my arms. I mean, I've had a hell of a lot of people die in my arms.
Looks like he cleared more than 22 years of crap in 22 minutes or less.
Yeah. It was just a plea, one of the most blood-curdling pleas, you know. And you can tell when somebody's faking it. But when you're dying, hey, it's no time to fake it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, this is nobody's
putting on an act when they're cashing in their chips.
No, they're not. I agree. I've had gang members die in my arms, and I've had some of the sweetest testimonies and some of the most heart-wrenching moments with hardcore gang members die in my ambulance.
That's because the veil drops, and they've got the full awareness of the oneness of the universe while they're still in their body.
Yeah. You know, people keep asking me why I don't go back in the pulpit, and I keep telling them, I just have trouble with the crucifixion, and it just startles people. You know, they're like, "Well, what? That's, I don't understand." You know, you're having trouble with the crucifixion. And I said, well, yeah, I'm having trouble with the whole Jesus Christ is the only Lord and Savior, and if you don't come to him through the Father, if you don't come through Jesus to the Father, you're going to hell. And I can't buy into all of this, you know, me against you kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I'm a Christian.
That's a paradigm misunderstanding, because that's not actually what the Bible says. But, you know, there's all these different interpretations.
Imagine if somebody... It is what the church expects, though. It's what the church expects.
But imagine... just imagine for a second if someone thought that the term drinking only meant being an alcoholic. So you said, oh, I'm going to go get something to drink now, and you meant RC Cola or coffee or whatever. And they're like, oh, you're an alcoholic. And you're like, no, I'm just getting a glass of coffee or whatever. Don't backpedal your way out of it now. You already admitted it. And you're like, what? And there's no way to convince them out of their view. So it's like that.
What is the answer to that, Dave? Jay, what is the answer? Propensity to create this problem for myself. I'm a fiery preacher. I'm a good preacher. I'm a good teacher. I can keep people mesmerized for 2 hours. You know, most people are screwing around. Most people screwing around going to sleep on most preachers, but they want more and more and more when I get up there.
Well, but what people miss is as Jesus said, I am the Son of God, and also are you. And he also said, because there was a group of people that, you know, when he did his miracles, they were saying, hey, you know, we're not questioning your power. We're kind of wondering which boss you're working for, if you get my meaning. And he said, the same Father within me is also within you. Is it not written in your law that ye also are gods? And, of course,
well,
there's another part
up,
of the book of John that's
up,
about all that
Dave,
I could do also.
Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and that he died on the cross at Calvary for your sins and the sins of this world?
I can't answer a direct yes or no because I have a bit more of an intricate answer to that one.
No, but just flat out. See, the Pentecost. See, my pulpit people would say, well, if you have an intricate answer, then you're out of here. You're not going to sit in my pulpit. You can please try to calm down a little bit here and just say, okay, let me think through this now for a minute. It's tough. It's really tough. And I'm sure
I understand. As a matter of fact, I've noticed if there's one of those, you know, shall we say, hateful fundamentalists that's dogging you, there's two Bible verses that'll get them off your back and getting them to want nothing to do with you real quick, and I've already mentioned it. The one where Jesus said, the same Father in me is also within you. Is it not written in your law that ye also are gods? And the one that says, all the works I have done also shall you do, and greater still.
Well, Let me snake through this, kind of slither my way through this, okay? I can believe, now see, you're going to get me on this one. I can believe that Jesus came and died on the cross at Calvary for our sins. I can believe that the Father said, hey, we got to do something here. This ain't working. There's laws up here in heaven. And I gotta figure out a way. An old Pentecostal told me this one time, by the way. So I gotta figure out a way to make this thing right because my life runs on laws. God's whole universe runs on laws.
And we call it quantum physics.
Yeah, but anyway, but just don't slip over there. Now let's stay here in the old fashioned pulpit for a minute. I can believe that Jesus died for our sins. That God said, "Look, I gotta do something. So I'm gonna send my son down, myself down." And I'm going to walk on the earth, and I'm going to do some miracles, and I'm going to bring a group together, and I'm going to get this thing started here where people will have something to believe in, something to have hope in and faith in, and something to center their attention upon, where the kind of like the founding fathers came together in 1776 and said, hey, look, we got to get together on this thing. We got to create some laws. We got to get away from the crown. We got to create our own situation now. I know that we're all divided, you know, from the East Coast north all the way down south to the East Coast. We're divided as hell. We're different as hell. We have different beliefs. We come from different cultures, different lands, but we're going to create the Americas. And similar to what God did. So, you know, is it okay for me to get up there and say, I can believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that he came and died for our filthy, rotten, dirty, perverted, stupid selves in order that we might have eternal life in some future place called heaven? What a wonderful thing. What a beautiful thing for the children. Now, I'm not a hell, fire, and brimstone preacher. I don't get up there and tell people that, you know, you're going to hell and there's fire and brimstone and gnashing of teeth. And people are going to be suffering. They're going to be crawling around naked in all this old black oil.
Yeah.
That's not a loving God.
That's not a loving God.
I just can't see that, you know. I just can't see that, you know. I'd rather just die. I told Mary, you know, I said, I'd rather just die and just meld back into the universe, you know, all my atoms, all my particles, all my pieces. That'd be just fine with me. But as far as this hell thing, I don't want to take no part in that.
Yeah, you know what? I agree with you. You know what? It's like, you know, they say how God is unconditionally loving and loves everybody and lovey, lovey, love. And then just like those New Ager chicks say to you, all of a sudden they go from love to F you, and it's like, wait a minute. A benevolent God does not go from I unconditionally love to, oh, well, you know, if you hold your thingy the wrong hand when you do your business, oh, you're going straight down to the barbecue. I don't believe in that God. I believe in the benevolent, loving God. And
then we bring up the hell part. We bring up the devil part. You know, if there's a yin, there's a yang. If there's an up, there's a down. If there's a good, there's a bad. If there's a God, there's a devil. You know,
if there's a God and if there's a devil, the devil ain't God, and vice versa. Like you said, yin and yang. So God is not going to be casting anybody to this hell.
But you think the devil might be us? You think the devil just might be us? I mean, we might have the devil in us, and we've created this evil. We are evil. We are dirty. We are perverted. Look at the world.
We're good.
We're
and
dogs.
Bad.
You know, we're dogs.
Attempting to kind of get at a specific angle on this. I believe in a benevolent God. Okay, and I've told people, if hypothetically this hypocritical, childish, so-called God that says he's unconditional one moment and then wants to toss you into the barbecue the next moment, that if he had a problem with me and wanted to toss me into hell or whatever, I'd say, well, you know, I believe in a benevolent, all-loving, all-forgiving God. So, if you don't mind, could you please just make me cease to exist?
Can I please talk to your supervisor?
I'm almost done with my point, like a sentence.
Go ahead.
And I would tell him, if you don't mind, please make me cease to exist because I don't want to suffer the embarrassment of having to go through all eternity in hell, having been created by you, one of your creations. I don't want the embarrassment of being a creation of a hypocrite walking around in hell with that on me. Can you please just make me cease to exist so I don't have to suffer the embarrassment of you in that hypothetical God that I don't believe exists? I believe in a benevolent, unconditionally loving God. That's what I
thought
believe.
You were.
And if any
Christian
wants to hate me for that, then well, that's their right. They can go ahead.
Were going to say, Lord, I just don't want to suffer for eternity down there with Kiler Davenport.
No, you wouldn't go to hell because heaven wouldn't want you, and hell be afraid of you taking over.
Yeah, couldn't you just ask God to let you see it? Let him let you see a supervisor. You could say, Father, can I see somebody else in charge here? Do you have anybody else at the front desk besides you? This is ridiculous. I need another plan here.
Yeah.
Jay, what's your take on that, what I'm having a problem with here? Because the pulpit's dragging me back, you know?
Well, what I think is the ancient Jews had an entity impersonate God that was basically called Yahweh. Yahweh is what you would call a limited God. You know,
yeah, he was.
Look,
what others would call a demon.
Mm-hmm. No, he was a limited God. That's the truth. It's in the Bible. He was a very limited God. It's even in the canons. He was more lawful. He was very lawful. They created this lawful God, the kind of a God of law. It's kind of like God was in the Old Testament. You know, in the Old Testament, everything was law, 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 and then God, Jesus, came to break the law. Jesus came to get rid of the law, you know.
Yeah. Well, that sounds like Yahweh was a God, not the God.
Mm-hmm. He was a God, yeah.
You're right.
Like Zeus.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Jesus doesn't want us living under the law. You know, the law is for people that break the law. The law is only for lawbreakers. It's not for enlightened people. We can use that word, enlightened, you know.
Well, the supreme law is love.
Yeah, the supreme law is love. And if you're enlightened, I hate to use that word for some reason, but if you're enlightened, you don't need the law. None of the books on the law apply to you. No contract, no state contract law, no federal contract law applies to you whatsoever. Because you are sovereign. You are a sovereign.
Operating in grace.
Yes, operating in grace, and you won't break the law. A good Christian will not break the law.
Can I quote David Icke?
Yeah.
David Icke says, we only need one law. Do as you will, as long as you're not enforcing your will upon another.
Yeah, makes sense. To a point.
Do whatever you like as long as you're not forcing your will on another. And David Icke says that some idiots come to him and say, oh, well, what about people who commit murder? And he's like, well, that sure sounds like someone forcing their will upon another to me.
You know, people come to church to get a real package deal. And my church wouldn't be that. I wouldn't give people a package deal. And that's the problem I think I'm having. You know, people come to church to get A, B, C, D, E, F, G, let's go home. Okay, it all sounded great, it's all perfect. Okay, we got the heaven thing, got the hell thing, got the sin thing. We've said our prayers now, we shook hands, let's go home. It's wonderful. But, you know, I get up there and screw everybody up, you know. I start talking like Dave Kelso and Jay Larson and us on the air. You know, I get up there and just start talking about all these different things. People enjoy it, but they leave with their mouth open. They're like, well, we didn't get a package deal here. What?
May I propose a theory?
Yeah.
Maybe the reason the pulpit's calling me back is because maybe your mission is to shake up people's paradigms and give them an alternate perspective. And maybe it's also for you to challenge yourself to move out of judgment, that anybody who walks away, you can see it as, okay, well, they have the right to walk away if they want. Maybe they'll be back. Maybe they won't. And maybe all the stuff that's happened in the last few months is to prepare you for that. All the people that walked away from your radio network, and now all of a sudden they're coming back in droves, apologizing and saying,
yeah, they are.
I had you all wrong. Well, maybe this is preparation for your pulpit work. Because maybe you're going to get a more expanded version of that. Maybe you're going to get up there in the pulpit, and you're going to Bible with some esoterics and metaphysics and quantum physics and whatever else. People's jaws are going to drop. They're going to walk away. But when they're away, they're going to think about themselves. They're going to go, you know, maybe Kyler might have a...
People are so confused. People are so confused, Dave. They don't get it all at church. They have so many questions that they keep to themselves. And I talk to people when I go to churches to visit. I'll talk to people, you know, how I am, and you are. We talk to people outside and in the Sunday school rooms and stuff, and they're all confused, and they just won't tell the pastor about it. You know, they just sit through the whole thing, and they won't tell. They won't even raise their hand. People are afraid, you know, to buck the pastor, you know. They want to raise their hand and say, well, I didn't understand this, or I didn't understand that, or why do you think that, or why do you keep saying that when it's not true, or why do you keep preaching this one thing that's not even in the Bible?
did you know that that Jesus explained how to handle that confusion?
Go ahead.
It's the whole thing about, you know, how the praying is the asking and the meditating is listening. Well,
yeah.
he does explain how to meditate. He says, make yourself like an empty cup so that you may be filled with the Holy Spirit. In other words, it's all of our stupid paradigms and compartmentalizations and expectations. This has to happen this way. This has to happen that way. That has to be that. That has to be this. Let go of it all. Get rid of it all and be like an empty cup. That's also why Jesus said, let the children come to me, for it is such as these that shall inherit the kingdom of heaven. And he also said the kingdom of heaven is within. So what he was saying is that these children haven't had the crap indoctrinated out of them. So they are like that empty cup. So if you teach them to go within, to pray, and then to meditate and to listen, that they will be filled with the Holy Spirit, because they haven't been taught how to not be filled with the Holy Spirit. So it'll work just fine for them. So you have
you
to
know
become
what else,
like a
what
child,
else,
like an empty cup.
What else is so? What else is so very, very, very interesting to me is the fact that Buddhists put Christians down so much. They do. Because you know me, I'm out there feeling the pulse of the world every day. And I mean, it's like these Buddhists, you know, they put Christians down terrible, horrible, you know, call them idiots and stooges and ignorant. And it's like, you know, just come in here and chant Nammyoho Renkyo, or just go to the priest at the Buddhist temple. Keep the Christians out. We don't want to hear any of your bullshit in here. Keep your bullshit outside. They've told me that. And
they've got their own version of the BS from what you've told me, especially on the Nam-myoho Renge-kyo thing. They don't even want to do the chant right.
No, they don't. And, you know, it's like, the other thing is the New Age people kind of bug me. You know, they don't want to talk about Jesus. They don't want to talk about God of the Bible. And this is something that God said exactly that they would do. And he said, you know, he predicted this. It's all laid out. It's all laid out, whether it's by the Vatican or by God or by First Testament Church, whatever.
Yeah.
It's all there, you know. And that kind of steers me toward Christianity. That kind of steers me toward Christianity because there was a metaphysical awakening
that started in the 60s, and the powers that be are like, no, we can't have this. So the powers that be created the New Wave, the New Age movement, which is basically a, excuse my French, but there's no other word, bastardization of metaphysics. And that's where you get all the shunning, because all these New Agers are about shun.
Yeah, I know.
A true metaphysician will acknowledge Jesus, will acknowledge Buddha, will acknowledge Gandhi. A true metaphysician acknowledges all in creation.
And I've also noticed a lot of these New Agers were molested. I've done some personal non-scientific studies on this. These New Agers, a lot of them have been molested, they've been beat, they've been dissed as women. They've been called queer by their dads. They've got all kinds of psychological baggage. They're submissive. They're kind of eccentric and strange.
A New Age is a trap to suck those people in.
Yeah. And it's like at least in the church, the good ones that I know of up here, you can go in and get prayed for, and people can lay hands on you and hold you and touch you and feel you and say, you know, it's okay, baby. The Lord loves you. That's all I'm going to say. I'm not going to bug you. The Lord loves you, and we love you. And I don't see that happening in the metaphysical circles that I run in and that I know of and that I've studied. I don't see that.
Those aren't metaphysical circles. There's a difference between metaphysical circles and New Age.
I just use that word. But, you know, it's like there's no Oz. There's no God. There's no end point. You know what I mean? In the middle, these new age groups, there's nowhere to go to get comfort. You know what I mean? And
Jesus was metaphysical. Do you know what the word metaphysical means?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, metaphysics, meta meaning expanded, physics meaning how the universe operates. So it's an expanded knowledge of the universe of God, and Jesus explained how to access that, to be filled
and the Holy Spirit.
Called the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit is a person of comfort, the comforter. The Holy Spirit is the comforter. And these New Age people, they don't have a comforter. They're all looking for the spaceship. They're all looking for the aliens under the North Pole. They're all looking for the grays to come back, or you know the bug-eyed beings, or you know.
Quite frankly,
to me,
the ETs are just like we are, good, bad, and everything in between. They're just people.
Well, I don't want to go there tonight, but I'm just.
I'm just making a punchline. I'm not going to go deeper.
I know. I'm just saying it just seems so much more comforting to me personally to have God and to have the Bible. As long as you don't go out cramming it down people's throats and telling them they're going to hell if they don't go with
you.
They don't come to your
even
church.
Even Jesus agreed with you when the disciples were saying, come on, Jesus, we got to force these people to see it. Jesus says, no. You teach by being the example. Force is resistance. It closes people's mind and disrespects their will. You have to be the example. Because the disciples had the idea. And Jesus is like, no, that doesn't work. You don't go there.
I just feel so comforted, you know, in my life. God has done a lot of things for me. And I know it was not some, you know, alien from another planet that was doing it, or my digital master, you know, or my handler. It was God, you know. I know it was, beyond a shadow of a doubt. I remember when I went out and prayed at the hospital when my mom was laying in a coma, and I'd never been a big prayer warrior then. I'd never been a public prayer person. And my mom was laying there in that coma, and she had tears coming out of her eyes, and the doctor came in and said, well, he said, Irene's not going to wake up. I'm sorry to tell you that she's had a massive brain hemorrhage, and I don't expect her to make it at all. And I definitely can tell you that she's not ever going to get up and hold your hand again. And I said, oh, no, please don't tell me. Please don't tell me that. And he said, well, I'm sorry. I can't tell you anything but the truth. And at that point in time, I had to make a decision. What am I going to do here, you know? And they had this prayer garden out in the front between the hospitals. They had this big, beautiful prayer garden with flowing water and everything. And I went out there to smoke a cigarette. And I was standing out there in the parking lot. And something just drew me over to that garden. And I went over to that garden and I sat down, and there was people sitting all around giggling and laughing and playing and jokes and all kinds of crazy stuff. There's a bunch of homeless people out there. And I just stuck my hands up in the air and I just started praising the Lord. And I just started crying. And I mean, I cried and I cried and I cried. And I prayed. And I said, God, if you will just take this pain away from my mother and just take her with you and let her die and go on home with you, or just take me home, take both of us home, or just give me her pain, give me her coma. And I said, I don't really know what I'm doing right now. And I said, I'm all mixed up. But I said, I'm asking you faithfully from the bottom of my heart, Lord, please let my mama live. Please, please let her just look at me one more time and say, I love you. And I remember walking the halls of that hospital all night long, and just a zombie. I was a zombie. I was just empty-headed. And I remember the next morning I was asleep in the chair by her, and I woke up and she was staring at me. Her eyes were as bright as the sun, and she held her hands out to me and she said, "I'm so hungry, honey." And I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt at that moment, I knew that God had done that. I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that God had heard my prayer. And that doctor came in, the nurse went to screaming, and you're running down the halls, and here comes this atheist doctor. He told me he was an atheist. Okay. And he said, "I don't think that God of yours can do a thing," the night before. He said, "I don't think that God of yours can do this, can override this." And he came running in the room, and he looked at her, and his eyes got as big around as silver dollars. And he looked at me, and he said, "This is impossible. It's impossible. This is some kind of anomaly. It's an anomaly." And I said, "What are you talking about? She's looking at you as plain as day. She has her hands out. She's hungry. She's awake. She's not in a coma." And he said, "You need to come out in the hall with me for a moment." And about that time, he had this thing in his hand. And he looked at me and he said, "I want you to look at this." And I said, what is it?" He said, "There's not one sign of a blood clot in this woman's brain." He said, "What did you do?" And I said, "What do you mean, what did I do?" He said, "What did you do? Did you pray?" And I said, "Yes, sir, I did." His name was Dr. Cabasso. I said, "Yes, Dr. Cabasso, I did." I said, "I cried and I prayed and I walked these halls all night long." He said, "This is impossible. It's impossible. This woman had an explosion in her brain the size of 3 golf balls." He ordered the nurse to go get another scan of her brain. They rushed her down there and got another scan of her brain. And he comes back to me and he says, "I believe that I'm going to start praying." And I said, "What are you talking about?" And he said, "This is impossible." And he just kept on. He said, "This could not be." And I said, "Well, it is, you dummy." And he said, "This God of yours must have some power." That's what he said. He said, "This God of yours must have some power." And I said, "No, let me tell you something. I've got some faith." And he just walked away.
Want me to tell you how Jesus would have probably responded to you?
Yeah.
He would have said, "I didn't do nothing. God didn't do nothing. Your faith, your power that God has granted to you healed her. Yours." Just the same thing as Jesus said to every single freaking person that he quote-unquote healed. He said to everyone, "I didn't do it. It was you. It was your faith. It was you. It was your power."
Let me open this line.
You all the things you do.
Stand by. Let me open this line up. 918, go ahead. You're on the line.
Hello. I'm just listening. I'm enjoying the show. It's my first time here.
Welcome.
Yes, glad to have you. Kiler Davenport
Thank
here.
You.
I'm on the line with Jay Kelso and with Jay Larson and Dave Kelso. How are you?
That
you have
was,
something?
I'm just beautiful. God has came through for me for this month and my situation, and I've written out my cue card for every room in the house, and I wake up every morning and go to bed with those words and that thought in my heart. And he that is in me is greater than he that is in the world. And
well,
I
that's
keep
what
that, yeah, I keep that all
kind of what the show's about tonight is kind of my I've been going through a lot of changes in my life, and I'm kind of coming back to my roots of simplicity in God and Jesus Christ, and it's been very difficult for me, being the intellectual nut that I am, and being the science person that I am, and studying quantum physics and world religion. It's been very difficult for me to get back to my basic roots, but that's where I want to go. That's what I want to do, is get back to some simplicity, and I want to believe it with all of my heart and all of my soul and all of my mind and all of my body, and not just halfway. You know, I don't want to do it halfway. If I go back in the pulpit, if I start teaching again, I want to make sure that I'm centered and that I know what I'm talking about and that I believe what I'm talking about. And that's what I wanted to come on Maiden Voice tonight, and I wanted to talk to my audience about that and get some input from the different people. I'm glad you came on.
Yeah. One thing that's definitely...
Go ahead, caller.
Oh, no, I think it's the time right now. It's this season. It's the time for all of that because it's so many people that are coming back, you know?
Yes, there are so many people. Where are you calling from, caller?
I'm calling from Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Wow, wonderful. I came through Tulsa last year. I have a friend in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
I've got some family in Oklahoma City.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's great. Am I down the street from where are you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I'm in Chicago, personally. And Jay's in Phoenix, Arizona.
I'm from Chicago.
Oh, really?
All my family's there.
588-2300. Only Chicagoans get the joke.
Empire.
Yeah.
Empire. Yeah, I've heard that one.
That's
wow.
It. I love you know this what? Show. I never knew. How long have you been on? I've never heard of the show.
I've been on for a couple of years. I started out with a 30-minute show on Blogtalk Radio and kind of grew the network, and now we're getting out around there, around the world. You know, things are really popping here. We're doing a lot better. I'm still not on the air at regularly scheduled times. I need to do that. I've been promising my audience. Dave keeps threatening to come over and beat me up. I've said this on every show, and I just don't get on.
I haven't threatened to come over and beat you up. I threatened to come over and cut off your... Never mind. Anyway, no, just
yeah,
playing.
Never mind. It's a Christian show here.
You know what? You know what, ma'am, though? One thing that, you know, I found that works for me in my life as far as changing my circumstances, and especially when facing those things that are difficult to face, is when the more thankfulness and appreciation that you can generate inside of you, and I mean genuine appreciation, thankfulness, not that dusting everything else under the rug and just pretending. I mean genuine, really resonating it and really like feeling it genuinely as much as you possibly can. And if you're able to hold that, I mean, that is the basic level of being filled with the Holy Spirit. That will start to flip around your physical reality. And, I mean, I do this all the time. When I see things not starting to kind of not really go a good way, I just, you know, I think of every possible thing that I'm thankful for and appreciative of, and I just start thinking about that and why I'm thankful for it and why I'm appreciative of it and feel it more and more. And because, you know, that's a frequency. Everything's energy in the universe,
yes,
right? We're all in the universe.
You feel it. Yes.
Frequency
into you. Yes.
Yeah, frequency attracts itself to itself, kind of like you won't see gold and dog defecation bonding together into something called shold, you know, as my friend Perry Cross made a return joke to me on that one day. You're not going to see that because it's two different frequencies. They don't come together. So when people are in this, oh, I'm suffering and I'm sad and I'm this, and they're in all this rut, that's a frequency that's compatible with bringing more rut. And so this is what Jesus is trying to teach people.
Let me interject something there. Yeah.
But it's got to be
Mary,
real saint. Yeah, not
Jesus. Yeah, Mary and I have been homeless, and we've been out there in the snow and the blizzards, and we've been hungry, and we've been out there lonely and scared and depressed. And when Mama died, and Daddy died, my sister died, my brother-in-law died, all these people died at one time, and we just left and came to the Northwest. And we got here, and I was driving on a flat tire down a one-way street crying, with Mary screaming at me, pull over, pull over, pull over, my God, pull over. And I was like, I don't want to pull over. And she's like, where are you going? And I'm like, I don't care. I just want to die. I just want to die. We're in this strange land. We know no one here. We're broke. We got a flat tire. We have no spare tire. The cops are everywhere. It's 2 o'clock in the morning, and I just want to die. And she started screaming, and I started crying, and we pulled over in this parking lot, and the cops came up, and we're trying to sleep. Our socks are stinky. Our underwear hadn't been changed in 2 or 3 days. We're depressed as hell. And all we could do is just pray. And I just prayed. Asked God to just lift us up and just hold us up through this, because we were literally about to just croak. And this cop comes up, and he goes, what are you doing? He's shining his lights on the car and everything. And I said, officer, I said, we're from the South. We just got here. We've had all these flat tires. We don't have any money. We're starving to death. And I said, I just don't know what we're going to do. And he said, I'll tell you what. He said, you just sleep here and don't worry. And he brought us food.
Wow.
Hamburgers and French fries and Dr.
Wow.
Peppers. And him and his partner got out, and they talked to us for a long time, asked us if we needed a blanket.
Wow.
And you know, that was just a moment, you know. I mean, he could have took us to jail. He could have took us to jail. He could have ticketed us for no trespassing. He could have done anything. He didn't even check our ID. He didn't even ask us for our ID. And so we stayed in that particular place for a while. And you know who turned us away? Do you know who turned us away? It was the churches that turned us away.
I knew you was going to say that. I was going to say, please don't say Christians.
Church after church turned us away.
Yes.
And it's the homeless that took us in. It's the felons that took us in. It's the drug addicts that took us in. And it's the ones who were the lowliest are the ones that took us in and helped us. The churches snubbed us.
Yes.
They didn't like the looks of our car. They didn't like the looks of our clothes. They didn't like anything about us because we didn't fit into their country club. And that really made me sick.
Yes.
It really made me... It really just gave me a worse taste in my mouth for false Christianity. It made me sick.
Yeah. This
and,
lady being from Chicago, I think she knows that most of the churches up here are exactly the same way. Fundamentalist,
yeah.
Catholic and Lutheran,
yeah.
And everything's a contest. They make you put your names on the offering envelopes,
yeah.
And they keep,
yeah.
Score.
Yeah.
It's
nasty.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah. Uh-huh. And we don't do drugs. We do not do drugs. We do not drink. We're matter of fact, we were up on the mountain tonight talking about just how boring we are, you know. And Mary's saying, well, why don't we have any friends? And I'm like, well, we don't smoke dope. We don't take methamphetamine. We don't do heroin, which is the going thing up here. We don't party. We don't like to go out and listen to loud music. You know, it kind of bugs me at my age, even though I'm a singer and a guitar player. But, you know, it's like we don't fit in. We don't fit in. And everybody up here smokes dope. I mean, everybody up,
yeah.
Here takes pills. You know, if you don't meet somebody up here and they're not high, there's something wrong. You got to call the police. You know? And it's like up here they arrest you for being sober. You know?
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Want to know if you're from there because you're not like that, you know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But we still don't fit in. And, you know, it's like church isn't supposed to be that way. You know, if Jesus had a church today, he would probably have people coming in crippled and sick and dirty and wetting all over themselves, you know, and just put them down at the altar and just love them and pray for them and hold their hands and just love them and stay there for 6 or 7 hours and eat and...
I think if Jesus was here today, he'd be on Comedy Central talking a lot like George Carlin and asking what the heck's wrong with people and what is this
Christianity stuff he sees, he doesn't recognize it from what was back in his day. It's two different things. What's wrong with you people turning it into this?
Yeah, he said, I will tell you, I didn't know you. People say, I will deny you because you denied the truth about me. You know, he says, I will deny you. It's a fire.
I remember that verse. It says the false bringers of light will come unto him and say, Lord, Lord, look at all the works we have done in your name, and he will say, get thee away from me, I do not know you.
I never knew you, he will say. I never knew you. Yeah. And you know, I can see why. And I just don't know what's happening to the world. It's you know, nobody really knows what's happening to the world. We have all these theories, but I'm going to go back to the old gospel. Mary's getting so tired of me, you know, flip-flopping on this. And, you know, she wants me to make a decision. I don't blame her, you know.
Yeah, you know what? Just be true to yourself. Define who you are as per your own definitions, and whoever accepts it, cool, and whoever
doesn't,
cool, too.
Well, you know, I pray to God so much. You know, I pray all the time, and when I pray, I shake the room because I cry. I get really, really in the Holy Spirit, and I just cry, man. And when I start crying and praying, oh, you better look out. I mean, the room is going to shake. It's going to take off, you know, and people get something out of it. It's a power coming through me, you know. It's not really coming from me. It's a power coming through me. I'm like a conduit, and people need that kind of prayer. I've seen it work miracles with people. You know, but you've got to stay with it. You can't be fake. You know, I see preachers get up and say all these fancy prayers and everything, and it's just okay. It's time to go home now. You know, and it just isn't work for me. You know, I'd rather see the old Pentecostal prayers. You know, I'd rather have somebody put their hands on me and shake me around a little bit, shake me up. You know?
Well, as Kiler will attest to. Well, he's seen this a lot more than once. Whenever anyone really gets into conversation, you know, that connected stuff with him or with me or with Jay or even with all three of us, there seems to be something that happens on the energetic level. The person ends up coming back later going, the heck did you all do to me? And it's like, what? Well, first all the bad stuff in my life and the stuff that I was, you know, all these things, these bad things that I was addicted to and whatever, everything started to crumble and fall apart around me, and then I was forced to pick up all the pieces of it again, and after that, everything's just so much better. And all these people that were bad for me just want nothing to do with me. And all, I'm meeting all these really nice people, and all this good stuff is happening. What'd y'all do to me? And it's like, well, we didn't do anything. But that,
you know,
just happened.
You know, there's so many hateful people nowadays. There's so many hateful people up here where we live. We live in a very liberal part of the Northwest, very hippie, a lot of hippies, a lot of metaphysical stuff, a lot of New Age stuff. You know, everybody up here has got a tattoo, which I'm not putting tattoos down. I'm just trying to give you an idea of who's up here, you know. We live in a very racist area where there's no blacks. You know, if you see a black, you're like, oh, my God, black, look, there's a black person, look. You know, it's like there's no black people up here. It's just weird all the way around. I'm from the South where we, you know, I grew up with black people and Hispanic people. But people are hateful up here. They're just downright mean. And,
Chicago's a mix.
You know, it's just, I'm wondering what's making everybody so dang hateful. It's just, it's got to be a lack of spirituality. I've talked about this with Jay before. You know, people are losing their spiritual root. They're losing their spiritual compass. They're losing, some of them don't even have and never had a spiritual compass.
Maybe you need to go down to Portland because Katarina's been having nothing but the most wonderful experiences with the most wonderful, loving, and open people, metaphysical, Christian, atheists, I mean, everybody. Katarina's been having the most wonderful experiences in the Portland area. Maybe you need to go check out Portland a little bit.
Well, we're going to do an art opening in Portland. I'll probably be meeting a lot of people over there, and I'm doing a new CD, and I'm working on a new play, live stage play, and I'm going to be showing some of my art over there, and we're going to be doing some lectures on long-term care. We're going to be doing some webinars on long-term care and some physical seminars on long-term care for all of you who are caregivers or taking care of a loved one at home. We're going to be doing a lot of education around the Oregon, Washington state area.
Did you know that Katarina got accepted into that 300 art festival thing? I'm sure you probably paid attention to her post on that, but you know what I'm talking about?
Yes, yes.
It's
wonderful.
Once a year in Portland. That's three. Only 300 are accepted.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Well, she got in.
It's wonderful, just wonderful. Jay, what are you thinking about all this?
Things are working in God's time, so to speak. Things are happening. They're happening in the right direction, in the right flow. All we need to do is go out and express.
I agree.
Ourselves.
I agree, 100%.
You know, the wonderful thing is when you show love to the hateful, they got to stop and think about themselves because you've completely challenged their reality.
Yeah, we were talking about that earlier, and that is definitely the truth.
That's what Jesus was talking about. That's what Gandhi was talking about. Buddha, all of them. The list goes on. That's exactly what they were talking about.
Well, caller from Oklahoma, are you having problems that God is bringing you through, seeing you through?
Yes. I'm sorry, I didn't mention my name. My name is Jacqueline Kennedy.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you. What I've been going through, I've been digging and putting myself into classes at church. I've been one called God ER. I go to Victory across from the Praying Hands. And Pastor is Sharon Doherty. And I started to put everything into focusing on him for the last 3 months. My disability from an attack on my job at a juvenile correctional here put me to where I ended up getting stomped and kicked in the face and head, and all of that ended up me going into post-traumatic stress disorder. And the next last year, I ended up trying to commit suicide twice. And doing that, I come to where now my long-term disability was cut off in October, so I'm like, what are you talking about? You know, so that left me with nothing. Nothing came in. And all I did was pray. And I'm to the fact that you have to, when you mentioned that you have to wait to get into the Spirit until it comes to you, that is exactly what you have to do. Okay?
Yes.
The thing about it is that I have a disability hearing coming up December 10th. Now, I was blessed. Doing all of this, I saw no way of me getting my rent paid for this month. Out of 2 months, this came about, long-term disability, recalculated and found that they owed me $400. I went to the church. They said they could not help me because they helped me in July, but they did come through at $300, and the court costs was added to the rent, so the eviction I got a week ago, they wanted me out. I've been here 13 years in this apartment. 13 in the same apartment from Chicago.
Wow.
And I have never had a problem. Everything's been together. My home is always clean and together. And we had new owners within the last 2 months. So I know the devil knows when you're trying to get deeper, closer to God, that he's going to come in with most of all the army he can bring to try to stop you. And it's so hard to set on it and go through it. And I still have to wait, look for December, what's going on. I don't want to have to sell my tech dining room set and my deep freezer. I said I didn't have to do it this month. I got to go deeper and believe in him to come through to the new year, because that's when my disability is supposed to kick in.
You know, Jacqueline, My theory has always been that we as people need to help each other more, and that's something that we don't do. Yeah. We talk a lot. We talk, pray, and we strut around the church, but we don't really reach out beyond that comfort zone and help each other.
We don't walk the walk.
No, we don't, no. And that's something that Marion and I always try to do. We do, we try our best to go. I mean, we live in our RV. We run the radio station out of the RV. We run the ministry out of the RV.
That is awesome.
And Jacqueline? We are always at ground zero with the homeless. We're always here in the streets. We're always where the action is. But most of the people we know up here are so living in a glass house, in a bubble, in a comfort zone, they will not reach out beyond their yard to help anyone.
And I think in a family of an 18-year-old girl and her 23-year-old husband, they weren't married, but when I took them to church with me, with their newborn baby from Chicago, I took them to the church. They talked to him. He got kind of upset because one of the pastors wanted to know why they weren't married and they're sleeping in the house with me. And I took them in because they was on the street. And once he was angry when we left the church, and I said, "Don't get angry at her. She's only going by what she's asking through the Bible. You are supposed to be. If you're going to keep going on, you shouldn't be making another baby without being with her. If that's going to be who you're going to be with." Well, they ended up going to the shelter because, of course, he started feeling his oats when he started, you know, feeling that he was making a little money now. He's got a little job. And I said, "You're going to have to go because, mind you, I took them in 3 weeks after I got jumped. And I had a brace on my neck. I had heard my neck pop. What happened was that one of the boys in the juvenile correctional, I was working there for 8 years. And he ended up, one of the boys was on the phone. I had to go to their unit, which wasn't my unit, because they broke someone's arm, one of their staff, and everybody's scared of that particular unit. My unit, I came off my off day, and they gave me the keys to the other unit. And I knew all the kids. They knew me. And now when I got on the unit, I said, "Okay, we're going to calm down." What happened was one boy was on the phone, another one was waiting, pacing back and forth to fight this boy that was standing next to me. And I knew the boy that's standing next to me, all of them. And they didn't take their meds. See, in Chicago, we will give you your meds. Down here, they have a choice.
Right.
That they don't have to take the meds or not. Well, they didn't take the meds on this unit. They did for a week. And they was taking this boy's food. So I told him, I said, "Look, you can have my food." And then I reached and told the other guy, "I'm getting ready to hang up. You've been on the phone an hour. Your shirt calls you to be on 15 minutes. Well, when I did that, the boy on the side popped the boy behind me in the nose. I turned and reached and grabbed him up from the back. When I did that, he kicked at the boy. We fell on my right shoulder. And when I did, I rolled and covered him with my belly. And when I did that, they stomped and kicked me in my head like they was kicking a bottle in the street. And kept on going. The guy that was working with me ran out the unit and locked me in when he closed the door shut on me. The security was looking to see what's going on. So the camera, instead of coming through there, they were scared. So I was stuck there. I got out the fight. Numb, mind you. I got out the fight, jumped across the stainless, grabbed the radio. I didn't know why I grabbed the radio. By that time, I couldn't feel nothing from my head to my breath. Now, after I put the radio down, something said, "They're killing them." I jumped back across the stainless. I dove back, wedged myself back into the fight, pried them off, covered them up again. They continued to stomp me in my face, my eye, my mouth, my shoulder, my ribs. Okay. I jumped up when security finally came, and I was so dazed that the camera was behind my back. My attorney, it was so messed up. They said, the other side said that you got back up. Anybody else, if they were so hurt, they would have been still down there. Well, I'm still going through somewhat memory lapse, where I could be driving and out of nowhere. And that's once every blue moon, I will not recognize where I am. And you try to explain it to your family, they do not feel it, because the first thing they said is, I'm the one down here. My rest of my family in Chicago and different places. But they feel like, "Oh, girl, get over it." Because you know Chicago, you're supposed to be tough as nails. Okay,
yeah.
I'm older. I'm 53 now. I understood that then. But right now, you get into a calm, a more relaxed feel you have to worry about who's standing outside to doing all of that down here.
Yeah.
They do. It is problems. Now, I'm not going to lie. It is problems. But I'm not on that side. I'm on a calm or mellow. I can handle my own here. But
what did they do, Jacqueline? What did they do with the boys that were kicking and fighting?
Oh, they stayed there. They stayed there until they closed the place down a year later.
Oh, my God.
They stayed there, and the security supervisor, the same boy, kicked him in the groin, and he had to have surgery. They still didn't do anything. So all they do here is put paper on them enough to lock them up for the rest of whatever time the paper sentence is. That's all.
You know, these kids up here are very violent, too. They're very,
yes,
very violent.
They're worse than down here. But the ones down here,
beating.
I keep telling them, that fagging came, okay, when I was in Chicago, I was working maximum security prison on 2060 California across at the White
Ooh,
Building.
County. All right,
now that... That was, they think that they're tough here. I said the sagging came from being in prison when they would call you was their woman, okay? Sagging
yeah.
meant this is my woman. You all don't even
yeah.
know why you're sagging.
Right, right, yeah.
Yeah, I think you already know then what the other name for 26 in California is that we all
oh, no,
call
I don't
26
know. I
in California.
Since 2005.
We Kyler, just so you know, we also refer to 26 and Cal as hell.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's Chicago's own hell. There ain't no
yeah.
place
yeah.
worse in Chicago than there.
Wow.
Wow. Wow, man. I've been out to L.A. Been on the east side. L.A., that's rough over there. Have you ever been to the east side?
Ooh. I've been to Oakland and Vallejo. I've never been in L.A.
Yeah, it's yeah. rough. Boy, you talk
you,
about scary,
usually,
man.
Usually it's all the violent offenders that are sent to 26 and Cal. Let me tell you, that place is so corrupt, even a lot of the guards are corrupt. I mean, it's like
oh,
you could go in there and get killed.
And then turn it back.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's
yeah.
nasty.
That's everywhere. That's, they are getting paid for doing... nothing, literally.
Well, Jacqueline, tune in, please, and be a fan. Contact me on Facebook, Kiler Davenport.
I am already.
And,
you know what? I think
get,
you are my. Yeah, I think you are my one of my Facebook friends. I do
yeah,
poetry,
I get,
and my name is Shyvina.
Shyvina, well, let me know that you were on the air with me tonight. PM me and leave it so I'll know we were who you are because I have so
okay.
many people out there, so many platforms. I like to keep my brain straight. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm on
already
tonight.
Already a fan.
Yeah,
I love
if,
you all
if you
already.
If you find Kyler Davenport on Facebook, you'll find me, Dave Kelso, on his friends list. Feel free to add me
okay.
if you want.
I will.
Jacqueline, if you'd like, would you like me to kind of give you a slightly more... positive spin on your current situation to kind of
yes,
leave you with a bit of a perspective on that.
Yes,
one thing that I've noticed in my life is that oftentimes God will take things away in order to move you into a position that's much better than you could have ever imagined. But because we don't see the full bigger picture when it's happening, we interpret it all as bad because there's some inconveniences. And because we have free will, we can sometimes attach and get in the way, get in our own way, get in God's way, and not end up at that good that's trying to come through because the things that no longer serve have to be stripped out of our life because they're in the way of the things that do serve. And then once those are stripped, the things that do serve can come forth. So what I would suggest, if you can bring yourself to genuinely do it, like what I was saying about thanks and appreciation,
yes.
is be in that state of thanks and appreciation and say to yourself, you know, if I end up out of this apartment, then it's because God is going to provide those circumstances for me that are going to line me up with someplace, some circumstances much better, and I
yes.
just won't be able to imagine it until I'm looking at it in hindsight. But in the
yes.
meantime, I'm going to
thank
have
you.
That faith and thankfulness.
Ladies and gentlemen, Kyler Davenport on with Jacqueline Kennedy and Dave Kelso, Jay Larson. If you want to email me, it's dkyler2010@aol.com. Dkyler2010
D. Kyler, thank you, East Coast. Appreciate that. DKyler2010@gmail.com. You can find me, Kiler Davenport, at DestinyRadioNetwork.com. That's Destiny, D-E-S-T-I-N-I-E. You can Google the station. Also, please, please go over and support UnitedCaregiversOfAmerica.org. Mary's working very hard over there for a professional association for caregivers, the ones who work in long-term care, as well as... Thank you, East Coast, again. The one...
You're coming out a little garbled there, Kyler. A little garbled.
Both licensed and unlicensed. We are out of here, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Dave. Thank you, Jay. Thank you, Jacqueline. I will see you guys on Facebook.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
God bless.
We're out of here. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Have a good night.